Well, by the same token, you don't have to force yourself or motivate yourself to think negatively, to be depressed, to hate somebody, to want revenge, to want to get back at somebody, to beat yourself up over the head, to feel loaded with guilt. You don't have to make any effort to do that. Your mind is on automatic. It will do that by itself. But if you want to begin to move into your own personal greatness, if you want to begin to really enjoy a happy, successful, healthy life, you've got to be willing to go against the tide. You've got to be willing to harness your will and say, in spite of this, I'm in control here. I'm not going to let this get me down. I'm not going to let this destroy me. I'm coming back, and I'll be stronger and better because of it. You have got to make a declaration that this is what you stand for. You're standing up for your dreams. You're standing up for peace of mind. You're standing up for health. You want it, and you're going to go all out to have it. It's not going to be easy. When you want to change, it's not easy. If it were in fact easy, everybody would do it. But if you're serious, you'll go all out. Yes, I'm going to turn this situation around. I'm not going to sit back and moan and cry over what happened and what went wrong and who did what. I'm going to do something about this situation. The next thing that is important is that expect things to get better for you, because they are. See, life is cyclic. You're not, whatever experience you're having right now, it has not come to stay. It has come to pass. Not to stay, just to pass. It's just going through. The biggest challenge is to know what's happening. This is a part of this thing we call life. This too shall pass. And maintaining perspective, putting it in perspective.
Discipline is like a set of magic keys that unlocks all the doors of wealth, happiness, sophistication, culture, high self-esteem, pride, joy, accomplishment, satisfaction, and success. The first key to discipline is awareness of the need for and the value of discipline, and especially the discipline to make the changes. What will it take? What must I do? And what must I become to get all I want from my life? The second key is the willingness. More than that, the eagerness to maintain your new discipline deliberately, wisely, consistently. And the third key to discipline is the commitment to master the circumstances of your daily life, to see and harness the opportunities to make something of the sun and the rain, the good as well as what comes in the guise of misfortune. Discipline does many things, but most important of all is what it does for you. It makes you feel better about yourself. Even the smallest discipline can have an incredible effect on your attitude. And the good feeling you get, that surging feeling of self-worth that comes from starting a new discipline, is almost as good as the feeling that comes from the accomplishment of the discipline. Second, a new discipline immediately alters your life direction. You don't change destinations immediately. That is yet to come. But you can change direction immediately. And direction is very important. Third, discipline cooperates with nature. Everything strives. It is a common life function. How tall will a tree grow? As tall as it can. Everything strives to become all it can possibly be. And that striving to become is what discipline is all about. Disciplining ourselves to fulfill our natural potential to become all that we can be. And finally, discipline attracts opportunity. Opportunity is always looking for ambition and skill in action. Discipline taps the unlimited power of commitment. The human will in action, driven by inspiration, enticed by desire, tempered by reason, guided by intelligence, can bring you to that high and lofty place called the good life.
Most people can't tolerate the deep face. I'm going to tell you, my God in heaven, let me tell you what he did. He repurposed my entire mess and built me a masterpiece. It protects the house. When there's a flood, that house doesn't get hit. It's got a bazillion goddamn rocks all over the place. And then the foundation's that, those stones are that, the entire house is protected that way. And then we took the dadgum water and we diverted it into the most incredible waterfall. Ask Ryan Stuman you've ever seen in your life. There's a waterfall that runs from 100 yards up my hill all the way down, cascading into the lake. Those rocks literally diverted the water that was coming from my family down into the lake. It repurposed my mess into building my dream. Let me remind you of something. Your mess right now in your life, if you got one going, does not disqualify you from making your dream happen. Everyone around you at some point is going to think you're crazy. There's going to be a point where your life was jackhammered and dynamited into a complete mess. And I'm telling you, from those greatest adversities, this is not rah-rah, I'm living proof of it, became one of my great dreams. And from that home is where I met all my mentors, have done the majority of my business deals. My net worth since I built that house has increased about $300 million from that mess, right? I tell you that I tell you that because that's going to happen for you. You got to be able to bend time. Man, do you hear me on this? There's a few things I know in my life, and I know what I'm telling you is right. Now, you better be able to do all the things you don't want to do as long as you can, so you can do all the things you want to do. You got to do all the things you don't want to do as fast as you can, so you can do all the things you want to do for as long as you can. Because you got 8 years left. Time's clicking. My life changed on time when I was 30 years old. You have anybody in your family that you resemble? You have like something. You look like your uncle or your auntie. You have anybody like that? Yes or no? Some of you? Mine was my Uncle Mike. It's my godfather. I'm Italian. That's kind of a big deal. It's my dad's only brother. He passed away walking through the Waldorf Astoria Hotel in the lobby at 50 years old of a massive heart attack. I went back to his funeral. And when I went back to his funeral, on the way back, the Oprah Winfrey Show was on TV. I'm going to give you a tip right now. There's a thing in your brain. I write about it in my book called the Reticular Activating System. It's called the RAS. It's the part of your brain that keeps you sane so that you don't notice all the stimulus in your life. It filters into you that which you're deeply convicted of or which is important to you. You will literally see, hear, and feel things that you would not otherwise see when something is very important to you. Let me prove it to you. You ever walk into a crowded room and you're looking for a particular person in that room? The rest of the room begins to blur out as you're looking for that. And when we left that room, if I said you were looking for Sarah, there were 40 people in there. When you leave, I said, who were the other 25 people in that room? You have no cognition whatsoever who the other people were in the room because what was important to you was Sarah. How many of you ever bought a new car before? You bought a red Acura. All of a sudden, you got that red Acura. Isn't it interesting? You see red Acuras all over the damn road. Same lane, three lanes over, going the wrong direction. You're like, man, everyone's got damn red Acuras. No, they were always there, but they were filtered out because they were not in your importance. If you're going to win, hear all this crap about the secret. There's some validity to it, but here's the truth. There's a reason in your brain that this is all true. It's called the reticular activating system. And if you learn to get super obsessed, your obsessions become your possessions. That's not a meme. That is a fact. When you begin to repeat a thought and a vision to yourself over and over and over again, like that house, over and over and over and over again, like the sale, like the best deal, like the steal on the street, like the investor you need to find, like the buyer you need to find, your RAS filters out like the Matrix and begins to find your red Acura for you. And if you don't begin to learn to control that, you lose against someone like me who understands it.
Because out of every tragedy, out of every pain, it only gets healed when we find a deeper meaning, when we find there's a higher purpose in it. And I realized I wouldn't have been there that day. I wouldn't have that hunger to help somebody else if I hadn't had the hunger in my own soul at one point missing. So it's very personal to me. I want to thank all of you that made the contributions. And I told Mark and I've announced that I'm going to match the million meals if you hit it. And I'm sure as hell expecting that you will. People who say money doesn't matter, they don't know where to shop. Because there's some experiences you can buy that are extraordinary. Who's got some experiences, some trips, some things you've done with family or friends that will live with you for years? Who knows what I'm talking about here, right? Those things, that money can be a really valuable tool there. If you can find enough add value and have money and do those experiences, how cool. I'll tell you what else money research shows will do. People always say money doesn't matter once you get to a certain level. No, it matters. You can spend $5 a month and have more emotional juice, and it can be measured all the way down into your saliva by hormonal changes. You want to use money, not let money use you.
But here's the problem. I used to be a head chef in a smorgasbord when I was much younger and used to cook. And working in a restaurant is an interesting thing because the church, in essence, is a restaurant. It is a restaurant. And let me tell you something. When you go to a restaurant, we choose restaurants, yes, because the food is good, but half of the reason we pick the restaurant is because of the ambiance, the atmosphere. Whether it be a casual atmosphere that you really, really enjoy, or I tend to like pristine atmospheres with white tablecloths and elegance and excellence and crystal and china and all the stuff I didn't get growing up, I'm still restoring that to the cankerworms. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm still eating steaks today because when my father ate steaks, we ate hamburger with gravy on it. And I'm still getting even. I just eat a steak and say, see, I'm grown. That's how I got this big, being grown. Bless God. But the church is a lot like a restaurant. When you go to a restaurant, everything out front is real nice and the music is playing. And the violin, and so the singer is singing over in the corner, and you got the white tablecloth, and you got the crystal goblets, and the china, and everybody's putting their, isn't that something about the putting a napkin in your lap? That's when you know you really have arrived. When the service is so good that somebody just comes up and just puts a napkin all in you. First time they did that, I thought they was getting fresh, you know, I thought, now, of course I've been on the road a while, you know, but, anyway, let me get past that. And so you're having this, maybe I should have stopped it tonight. I don't want to mess you up. But you have this great experience in the restaurant, but that's not how it is in the kitchen. In the kitchen, you got leftover lettuce heads over in the corner that you got to throw away, and you got stuff bubbling and boiling and cooking and spilling over, and people are yelling at one another, I said, bring the soup. It's behind. We got to get the out front. They're saying, may I help you? It's not like that in the kitchen. In the kitchen, all hell is breaking loose.